It is the official first full day of summer. June the 21st, game two of the four-game series between the Pittsburgh Pirates and the San Francisco Giants. The Buccos winning last night, a thriller, 1-0. And again, this is game two of the series. Greg Brown along with Bob Walk and Dan Potash. And tonight we're going to see a guy who we saw a little bit of earlier this year. He's made five relief appearances for the Pirates. He's going to make his first big league start tonight. And Bob, that is Wilfredo Boscan.
You know, one of the things we saw when he was up here last time, and we heard about it before he got here, was his great control, and he was able to show us that. I mean, he's a young guy that comes up and really knows how to throw strikes. He is not afraid of the bat, goes right after the hitters, and he can do it with more than one pitch. He'll throw his breaking balls for a strike, fastball, move it around. That's what I'm looking for tonight, that command that he has of more than just one pitch.
It's going to be a thrill for Wilfredo Boscan tonight because he's opposed by one of the game's best, Johnny Cueto. Very familiar foe for the Pittsburgh Pirates, will be on the hill tonight looking for his 11th win of the year.
He's always tough for us, except for that one magical night. I mean, he comes in here and it's like he's got a magic wand when it comes to the Pirates. Hopefully tonight we'll be able to get some runs off of him and we can outpitch him for the win.
You see his ranks in the National League brought to you by Barrel. He looks to join Clayton Kershaw and Jake Arrieta as the National League's only 11-game winners. The Pirates will look to stop him from accomplishing that feat. What a feat last night. Eric Kratz, his first Pirate homer. The Buccos held on for a 1-0 win. Game two, Bucks Giants next.
Pirates Baseball on Roots Sports is brought to you by Allegheny Health Network, health for all, and by Day Automotive. We're going to make your day. Let's go, Bucks!
Another beautiful night for baseball in Pittsburgh. The Pirates tried to make it two in a row over the San Francisco Giants. Rick Sofield and David Fries doing their own little dance. And the Pirates dug out. There's Wilfredo Boscan seated in the dugout. Good to see Ray Searidge is back. Ray Searidge sent home last night with back spasms and arthritis flared up in his left wrist. So Bucks hoping, as we said, to make it two in a row. They ended the Giants' eight-game win streak last night. Gregory Polanco, Sean Rodriguez, Matt Joyce, Andrew McCutcheon, Josh Harrison. And Wilfredo Boscan will take the field all by himself initially. And then the rest of his teammates will follow. Though he has made five major league relief appearances, this will be something new for Wilfredo Boscan, his first major league start.
Yeah, a few more butterflies, obviously, that coming in out of that bullpen. You're in the big leagues. You're doing something you've always dreamed about, but making a start, that'll add a little leverage to the situation.
Bruce Bochy's San Francisco Giants lead the National League West by 5.5 games over the Los Angeles Dodgers. This is the Honda starting lineup. Denard Span returns to the starting lineup, leads off Joe Panik. Brandon Belt follow. Belt hitting 365 his last 20 games. Buster Posey, a little scare last night. Just turned out to be a little cramp in the hamstring, and he is behind the plate with Brandon Crawford at short. Angel Pagano left, Gregor Blanco, Connor Gillespie, and Johnny Cueto, the starting nine for the Giants. Madison Bumgarner, tough luck loss for him. While Jeff Locke went 6 2/3 innings of five-hit shutout ball to get the win.
Take a look at Boscan's numbers, brought to you by Hyundai. And five games, all in relief. You see the five walks there. That came mostly in one game, if I recall, Greg. He had been really a strike thrower going after the hitters. And then in one game, he suddenly wasn't. But I think in a starting role right now, he's going to fill up that strike zone.
Checking out the defense, brought to you by Honda. David Freese back over to the other side. He's now at the hot corner tonight with Jordy Mercer at short, Josh Harrison and John Jaso on the right side. Marte McCutcheon Polanco in the outfield left to right, and Jacob Stallings makes his second major league start behind the plate, and Denard Span leads off strike one, and right away Stallings tosses that ball out of play, and that will be authenticated. Span rested last night, hitting 248 with the Giants this season. Ball to strike on Span, and Bob exactly right that one bout of wildness in a relief appearance against the Angels on the third of this month. Next day he was optioned back to the minors. But he was just throwing strike after strike in his four first major league relief appearances.
Yeah, really impressed with the command that he had with all of his pitches.
Hard hit, but there's Josh Harrison.
Using his defense, that's all.
He's got a good one behind him. Rivers Casino tips to win.
Pitch like a boss can. And a boss, he shuts the other teams down. And I think that's how you got to beat a team like the Giants. You got to do it with a superior pitching on that mound. And that'll bring back the glory days for the bullpen, which is kind of what we saw last night. They had the bullpen, the seventh, eighth, ninth inning work like we saw it so many times in the previous couple of years. And we'd like to see that work again tonight. Get your seventh, eighth, ninth inning guys all lined up.
Boss can.
Yeah, pitch like
B-O-S-S, and then glory days. So I didn't know you were such a big Bruce Springsteen fan.
I'm just one of those
well-rounded.
Guys.
Is what you're saying.
I can go a lot of different directions.
This time an easier play for Harrison. Joe Panik is retired and doesn't look real comfortable walking back. It looked like was not necessarily busting it down the line. These Giants have already had their share of tough luck injuries. Brandon Belt hitting 304 on the year, 1-for-4 last night. He singled in the ninth against Mark Melancon to start that frame. And then Buster Posey, when he hit that fly ball down the line in right field, Polanco made the catch, and Belt took a big gamble and reached second base and was doubled off first. And saw Posey, as he was heading to first base, grab the back of his hamstring, back of his leg, and turned out to be just a cramp. One ball, one strike on Belt. One and two on the first baseman. It'd be nice for Boscan to bounce right back. Have a 1-2-3 first inning, his first major league start after that rough relief appearance against the Angels. Struck him out looking. Pitching like a boss can.
We're going to go right back to the glory days. I can see it.
Dinning. Giants go down 1-2-3, and that young man wants John Jaso to have a hit or two for him on his birthday. RAV4 starting lineup. It is Jaso, Gregory Polanco, Andrew McCutchen, David Freese hits cleanup. Starling Marte tied for second in the batting race. He followed by Josh Harrison, Jordy Mercer, Jacob Stallings, and Wilfredo Boscan. Seen this guy before, haven't you?
Yes, we have, and he has always been very good against the Pirates, especially here at PNC Park, except for, as we talked about earlier, that one game where he dropped the ball that night. He's a tough one. One of the better pitchers in the league, no matter who he's pitching against.
The Cueto chants have even started before the first pitch. John Jaso is wondering what's going on with these chants. Ball one. You look at his resume and his numbers against the Pirates, it is hard to believe they roughed him up like they did that October 1st, 2013.
Magic night. It had to happen.
Since 2013 regular season numbers 6-0, two complete games against the Pirates, 16 career regular season games here. He's 10-2 with an ERA of 1.91. 30-year-old from San Pedro de Macorís in the Dominican Republic, who signed a 6-year, $130 million deal this winter. Dave Righetti, the Giants pitching coach.
Somebody won. It's a record. Righetti
pointing out to the bullpen and then pointing at his at the hat. That's something to do with sunglasses, I wonder.
Hit hard to right field for Jason right away. A leadoff double.
You know, one of the things that when you have lifetime numbers against a team, you have to always think about, well, there's a turnover in players every year. Well, Jaso doesn't know anything about those pirate numbers. He wasn't around for that.
Lines it into right field. John Jaso leading off with a double. His 13th. Excellent opportunity to jump on Cueto early. Gregory Polanco, 2-for-9 in previous matchups against Cueto. Polanco 1-for-2 with a walk and a lineout last night. Look out. Almost hit it behind him. Polanco 39 runs batted in. That total leads the Pirates. Fielding Colbert, the home plate umpire, said inside. He is the crew chief with Jim Reynolds at first, Manny Gonzalez at second, C.B. Buckner at third. Buckner was behind the plate last night. One ball, one strike, Andrew McCutchen on deck. Little broken bat, one hopper, and nice read from Jaso. You could tell that panic wasn't going to get to it before it hit the dirt, so he moves on. And this is what Bob was talking about. October 1st, 2013. Cueto drops the ball. Then with the Reds and the next pitch. It was magical that night.
One of the most memorable, I think, sporting events that
Pittsburgh's ever seen.
Yeah, anybody in the city has seen a long time. It's one when you start talking about the different events that people remember that night, will definitely at some point have to come up.
Well, the infield back and Brandon Belt playing almost halfway between first and second. An unusual defensive alignment with Andrew McCutchen at the plate. Denard Span now has sunglasses.
Yeah, that was the phone call from the bullpen. It was about getting Span something to cover his eyes. Tough sun.
That little cue shot would have been all kinds of trouble had it been fair. 290 lifetime against Cueto. McCutchen 0-for-3 last night. Hit the ball at the warning track and left. Flied to right and bounced to short. For all intents and purposes, conceding the early run. Bob, have you ever seen a first baseman play that far off the bat?
Fado sometimes will get off not that far. He's the only guy I can think of that'll move around like that. You got to be very confident in your athleticism and your quickness to be able to get over to that first base back.
Look at that. Line to left, but hooking. Foul.
Awfully close.
Cueto has given up only 3 home runs this season. Trevor Story took him deep with the Rockies May 29th. Votto, just talking about the Reds first baseman, former teammate, homered off of him at Great American Ballpark May the 2nd. And Yasmani Tomas of the Diamondbacks April the 21st. Just 3 home runs allowed this year. Johnny Cueto. Finished up last season with the Royals. Midseason trade with Cincinnati. Brandon Finnegan, John Lamb, and another minor league pitcher, Cody Reed, went to the Reds in that deal.
Infield's kind of snuck in a little bit.
Yeah. Now they've decided with two strikes they might take a shot at home. Cueto does that little quick pitch with the windup. He does all kinds of stuff on that mound. Looked like he was going to go into a slow delivery and then brought it home.
Yep, there it is. Breaks his delivery. Doesn't mess with his mechanics to be able to do that?
Apparently not.
Now he gives
and then he goes into the slow turn.
Gives a look like a
changeup.
Slow turn, looks like he's getting ready to maybe try to really unload a fastball, and I believe that was just a changeup. Big spin. Yep, changeup.
No two outs. And now David Freese, 222 lifetime hitter against Cueto.
You know, you get older, you're not throwing 95, 96. You gotta get crafty. Cueto, over the last couple of years, you could see him evolving into a different type pitcher.
Comes Brandon Crawford. Cueto gets out of it. Leadoff double, then a little broken bat, one hopper to second, struck out McCutchen. Freeze bounces out. Second inning at PNC Park. Game two of the four-game series. Bruce Bochy had another player land on the DL today. Allegheny Health Network injury update. Matt Duffy, his third baseman, went on the DL. And that ends his consecutive games played streak. Actually, it ended yesterday. Didn't play 188 games. Was the leader among active players. MRI yesterday. Strained Achilles tendon. And so now, Jose Altuve of the Astros has played in the most consecutive games in Major League Baseball. As Posey takes a strike. I want to say that's about 150 or so. It is a different time, to say the least. Duffy had taken over the lead among active players at the 188 mark, overtaking Manny Machado of the Orioles, whose streak ended at 229 when he started serving the four-game suspension for the fight with Yordano Ventura. And 1-2 the count. So a big relief that Buster Posey is in the lineup. Big relief for Bruce Bochy and the Giants. Not look good at the end of the game last night. He taps that foul.
Yeah, I would have made a wager if Posey would not be in the lineup after seeing this.
Watch him grab the back of his leg.
Right there. Boy, that's a classic reaction to a pulled hamstring, but didn't happen.
To the shortstop, Mercer. One down. Easy for Mercer, especially Posey. Maybe taking it extreme caution.
I really love the way Boston just getting ahead of the hitters, throwing strikes. This is like what we saw from him those first four outings he had as a Pirate, coming out of the bullpen, just going after the hitters, being very aggressive with all of his pitches. And that was fastball. He could throw anything he wants, pretty much wherever he wants to. So it looked like a nice changeup.
And he picked up where he left off in Indy. A lot of times those numbers aren't indicative of what a guy does in the big leagues. General managers, managers, pitching coaches always cautious about that. But, you know, the numbers might not translate to the big leagues, but with
most of the time they don't.
Yeah. But with Boscan, he was a strike thrower at Triple A Indy. What, four walks and 49, 50 innings all year.
It's nice to have Stallings back there for him tonight. Somebody's caught him.
Caught him occasionally. That's interesting too.
Oh, has
Stallings caught him opening day this year, and that was pretty much it.
Really?
Dean Traynor decided to have Stallings catch Tyone, Glasnow, and Chad Kuhl, and this ball hit well towards center field. McCutcheon will make the catch.
Beautiful.
Stayed with it. Andrew McCutcheon
having to fight that sun, looking back into it early in the ball game. It's always an issue for the center fielder here. Looking up, makes the jump.
Allegheny Health Network Super Bowl, Andrew McCutcheon.
I like that new glove of his, too.
I think he does, too.
Oh, what was it, the six-finger style? And just didn't look like that ball was like nestled deep into the pocket like it does on those open web clubs.
Boscan liked it. Why not?
That's a nice look too. The black and gold.
Oh, yeah.
On the glove. And I'm talking about the gold patch.
Yeah.
Of the Rawlings.
The real gold.
Yeah, that's a class look.
This angle. This catch.
Sitting in the second deck, you're going to be saying, oh no, oh no, on that one.
Good seat to have, though, beyond the right center field wall. Get a real good look at that McCutcheon catch. Pagan takes 2-1. Angel Pagan led off. Last night was 1 out of 4.
Had a chance at a nice catch himself.
Yeah. Talk about frustrating. Would have been one of the great catches of the year. One of the great catches, really, you'd have to say, top 10 maybe all time here at PNC Park had he held on. Eric Kratz.
Brian Giles.
Home run. Yeah. Struck him out looking.
Boy, he's painting in and out, up and down, throwing strikes.
And we'd like to welcome Shentel cable viewers in the Pineville area. Thanks for watching and rooting on your Pittsburgh Pirates. All of us at Root Sports and the Pirates appreciate your support. Here at PNC Park, bottom of the second, nothing, nothing. Six up, six down for Boscan. Starling Marte. And Andrew McCutchen returned to the dugout. There is Wilfredo Boscan.
Yeah, you better thank those outfielders. Most of the time, they're not stopping singles. They're saving you from at least a double when they make plays like that.
Two strikes.
One of my favorite responses back in the old days when somebody would ask me, what do you have going for you last night or tonight? I would say, I had fast outfielders. That's what I had going for me. Yeah, they can turn the game around. As we saw last night with Blanco in the ninth inning.
Yeah, no question.
That's an absolute game saver.
One away, Bucks in the national spotlight. Sunday night, take on the Dodgers, 8:08. All kids 14 and under get an Andrew McCutchen new replica alternate jersey, compliments of Chevrolet. Go to Pirates.com for tickets. Sunday night, 8:08, Pirates Dodgers. Andrew McCutchen replica jerseys.
One of the fast outfielders.
Yeah.
Pirates are lucky enough to have three of them in the same outfield. That play, Blanco made last night in the ninth inning. I mean, obviously Belt was shocked.
Yeah.
There's no way that ball's being caught. The only explanation for what he did. And he went from what would have probably been second, third, nobody out, to two outs, nobody on. I mean,
it was a game changer.
Good outfielders. They can absolutely win games for you. Their plays that they make, exceptional plays, are just golden.
Pagan came close to making an exceptional play,
but he didn't. And
because of that, Kratz got the home run.
The game-winning home run.
Off that man, Madison Bumgarner. Two and two on Harrison. He's a .333 career hitter against Cueto. Starling Marte, who just struck out, 1 for 24 in his career. So you go from 1 for 24 hitter to those numbers, 7 out of 13. And he ties him up, the strikeout, two outs, back to back K's. Cueto has struck out 93 batters.
Not the same type guy that we used to see years ago with Cincinnati. Remember when he first came up, a young flamethrower. Quite a pitcher.
Quick pitch and up the middle, a base hit. Jordy Mercer, whose first big league hit was against Johnny Cueto. Two out single here, and Jordy Mercer will be the Twitter Tuesday guest. Dan Potash will have that feature.
They put a quick swing on him. Get a quick pitch, get a quick swing. Barely quick enough. Bat it's no good anymore. Quick pitch got in his kitchen, jammed him, but didn't matter.
Here's Jacob Stallings. Second major league start was 0 for 4 at Wrigley on Sunday night. Stallings, a seventh round pick of the Pirates in 2012. University of North Carolina. Dan Potash talked to his dad Kevin last night, the Pitt basketball coach. One ball, one strike. Now 1-2 with Wilfredo Boscan on deck. Still 1-2 on Stallings. We got a good look at Jacob Stallings in spring training. Was very impressive down in Bradenton.
Yeah, I think he really opened some eyes.
Yeah, non-roster invitee down to Bradenton and was really impressive. He was hitting as well, and that didn't continue with the AAA Indy.
It was kind of the hitting. Okay, that's good, but the way he played the game, I thought opened eyes. The way he ran the bases, his hustle. That was the reason I noticed him right away.
And you know what? He had at bats just like this that we're seeing here.
But I especially recall a time where he went from first to third on kind of just a single where a lot of guys would have held up. And you know,
being a smart baseball catcher,
you know, it was like, wow. He ran hard when that ball was hit, made a nice turn around second, took advantage of the situation, got himself to third, wasn't just happy about jogging down the second.
And he'll be retired, it would seem, as Panic makes the catch. Two out single by Jordy Mercer. He's left stranded. Two innings complete, nothing, nothing. Sorting through all the pivotal player movements in Pirates history, loaded with earth-shattering deals that involved Hall of Famers, built playoff contenders, and finalized championship teams. Countdown to our Pirates 10 Great Trades on Inside Pirates Baseball tonight after post-game on Root Sports. UPMC scoreboard, it is nothing, nothing. Head to the third.
I'm trying to get that baseball to sit on the paddle. Like a little artistic shot there.
Trying. Greg Verblanco leads off.
Watch the hitter if you're sitting in those seats.
Yeah. Blanco tries to bunt, and it is a foul ball. Freeze started to charge. Stallings grabbed it in foul territory. Assume Blanco's okay. Comes back to that batter's box slowly. 0 for 3 last night. Strike.
Hank.
Yep.
Impressive start.
Oscon was picked up by the Pirates a couple of years ago. This is his second year in the organization. Last year at Indy went 10-3. They signed him as a minor league free agent. Originally the Texas Rangers signed him in 2006, and that is a fair ball. Marte gets it in after the Blanco double.
Marte always challenges those runners. If you've hit that ball down in the corner thinking, okay, that's a double, you might get thrown out by Marte, because he's not taking anything for granted. He's going to get the best rebound he can off the wall and fire a strike in a second. Greg White's aboard.
Now Connor Gillespie. Jordy Mercer in on that play. On deck, Johnny Cueto. First hit of the game for the Giants is a leadoff double. Connor Gillespie hitting 159. Just three hits in his last 33 at bats. Returning to the Giants. Signed a minor league deal over the winter. They drafted him initially back in 2008. Did he go? Yes, indeed.
Definitely offered at that one.
So he is starting at third base again. Matt Duffy on the disabled list now. And McCutchen. Blanco tagging. But he's not going anywhere. Gillespie flies out. Runner remains at second, and now Boscan will face Johnny Cueto. Boscan gets the first out of this third inning. Stallings out to talk to Boscan. ...26 years old from Maracaibo, Venezuela. Rangers minor leagues for a while. San Diego Padres picked him up in a trade for a minor league pitcher before the 2013 season. Red Sox signed him as a minor league free agent. Spent 2014 pitching for that organization. Cueto with a couple of RBIs this year, 2 for 32 at the plate. Wow.
Nothing wrong with that pitch. Didn't get the call.
No, I don't understand. That was a, that wasn't one that like just caught the edge.
It wasn't really borderline at
all.
Yeah,
the whole baseball in the strike zone. There it is.
Ball a strike on Cueto. Stallings went back to take a look. Parrott wanted it. One ball, one strike. Cueto trying to help himself. Career batting average of 103, with a dozen RBIs in his career.
I can remember one of those RBIs. Came like in the bottom of the eighth, Cincinnati. You
sort of
that?
Interrupt there, Bob, but there's another pitch that could have been called a strike.
Yep.
Which game was that?
Remember that he got a, they let him hit late.
Oh,
in the
my
game.
Goodness, yeah.
He knocked in the run and then they took him out.
That was toward the end of the 2014
trying to get
season.
20th win or something like that.
2-1. Freeze. On to Jaso. Two outs will bring up Denard Span, and Blanco still at second in this scoreless ball game. Day Automotive, this day in Pirates history, is on this day in 1989. Doug Drabik and Greg Maddux, toe to toe in a classic pitching matchup. They go 11 innings. Neither factors in the decision. Maddux went 10, allowed 6 hits. Drabik went 9, shutout frames, gave up 5. Pair of yet-to-be Pirates that combined for the lone run. Lloyd McClendon, sacrifice fly, drove in Gary Varsho to give the Cubs a 1-0 victory. This date in 1989. Span takes ball one. Former Pirate Josh Fogg is here during batting practice visiting. Bucko pitcher, his family on hand. He was a strike thrower, didn't wow you with stuff.
Yeah, very similar to the way Alfredo pitches.
Pop up, freeze, a leadoff double, and Blanco doesn't move. Alfredo Boscan, 3 scoreless. good news certainly for the Mets. Bottom of the third, nothing, nothing. Pirates have their pitcher, Wilfredo Boscan, leading off against Johnny Cueto. Be followed by John Jaso and Gregory Polanco. Yes, hoping to do that. Let's go, Bucks. It does take an imaginative pitcher. Bob was talking about Cueto, how he has changed, as many pitchers do as they age and lose velocity and reinvent themselves, and he'll do that pitch to pitch. There's a little quick pitch against his mound opponent, Boscan. One away. We'll bring up John Jaso. By the way, we send our thoughts and prayers out to former Pirate Andrew Lambeau, who's playing AAA ball for the Oakland Athletics, who announced today that he underwent surgery on Friday for testicular cancer. And they're pending the results of the pathology and imaging tests. And he sent out a tweet today. Thank you, everyone, for the prayers and support. Truly blessed to have so much love. Going to beat this and be back on the diamond. We wish Andrew Lambeau the best. The A's claimed him off waivers in November. So much promise for Andrew Lambeau when he joined the Bucks. There were flashes of big numbers in spring training and in the minor leagues. Health was an issue for him. He got hurt a number of occasions. The hope was that he would be the first baseman of the future eventually when he learned that position. Doing some outfield work in their minor leagues, and so John Jaso was signed over the winter. The count on Jaso. Doubled to start the Pirates first, but Johnny Cueto able to retire the next three, including Andrew McCutchen, with Jaso at third base and just one out. Hare. The Dreads. Who wins the battle of the Dreads this time, Bob? It was Jaso that won it in the first inning.
I think it's going to be a continuing battle.
Uh-huh.
Jaso is definitely pulled far ahead here with the leadoff double.
Cueto trying to tie up this battle.
What's that? What do you call it when the ends are lighter color than the
tips? Like
tips. I like the how the little two tone look.
Yeah,
on Jaso's.
Yeah.
The house got a little lighter to it. That's how Kutch used to have kind of.
Yeah.
There's a name.
The highlights.
There's a name for that. No, it's not frosted.
Who said frosted? Three and two the count. And now Jaso calls time as Cueto takes a little too much time. What will Cueto throw at him? Payoff pitch. Ripped foul. Look out.
Hombre, that's what I was trying to think of. That's a long way from Frosty. Hombre. So I knew that there was a word for that look. So you and I, we look like hombres because we're half silver, half whatever. Or I guess you'd call it gray.
Whatever. Whatever, Russ. Now waiting for either Belt or Cueto to get to the bag, and Panic will throw to Brandon Belt. Play goes 4-3. Battle of the Dreads. It's now 1-1. Jaso doubled in the first and bounces out here in the third. Two up, two down, two ground ball outs for Cueto. nothing ball game. 18 wins against the Pirates, leads all active pitchers in wins against the Bucks. And again, 7-0, a 1.58 ERA his last 11 starts against Pittsburgh. That six-year, $130 million deal signed in the middle of December includes one of those opt-out clauses after 2 years. By that time, he will have been paid $46 million. And if he does indeed decide to exercise that opt-out clause, he would forego another $84 million. Brandon Belt with a pick and a 1-2-3 bottom of the third. Dreadlocked, nothing.
The Bucks and Giants scoreless as we head to the fourth. Here's a look at Jordy Mercer, who is not just a shortstop tonight. He's our guest on Twitter Tuesday. Let's begin with our first question. We actually got this more than once. It's from I Heart the Frasers. Jordy, why do you tap your chest before each at bat? Nervous twitch or a secret message to home?
Well, I have my cross necklace on, and so I kind of move it over because it fits. It's kind of like a habit thing, but also just lets me know, like, you know, how blessed I am and how lucky I am to be here. And and so every bat I move it over to my left side of my chest just to remind me that it's there, remind me that, you know, what we're here for.
So not a nervous twitch. We thank you for the tweet, but there's more to come, guys, so stay tuned.
I look forward to that. Jordy Mercer, the Oklahoma native. Joe Panic. Ball one strike. This is what Jordy was talking about there. One and two on Panic.
You know, I thought maybe it had something to do. Remember a couple years ago, he got hit right there with a fastball right in his chest. Missed a couple of games after that. I mean, it was almost right that spot that he touches every time.
Fredo Boscan retired the first six, gave up a leadoff double to Blanco last inning, and got the next three. Two and two. Ah, yes, it's a pup night. Boy, did we get, by the way, the last time you and I were on, and you brought up the idea of
cat night?
Cat night. Did we get some texting and tweeting and.
Oh yeah. Oh,
my gosh, what you've done. You know, the Pirates front office not real happy with you. They you know, you tied up those phone lines.
Hey, I just threw a little something out there.
A little something. The chaos you created.
Yeah,
mayhem.
I like fairness is all.
Many of the pups themselves were making phone calls, texting and tweeting, saying no.
And I don't think cats do real well on leashes, so they would just have to be walking free up there.
Yeah.
You just bring your cat.
Yeah.
And then the cat could just groom
wander
where it wants to go during the game.
Yeah.
Cat night. Yeah, I get a lot of feedback on that, Rick, to be honest with you. Forgot all about that.
Broken bat, little base hit for Joe Panic to start the fourth.
Most of the feedback was, what are you talking about?
And I got a couple that said, absolutely, please. Love the idea.
I got some of those too. Look how happy that dog is. Doesn't want to be anywhere else in the world right now than a Pirate game.
With a Marte jersey on.
Yep. Happy as can be.
And a Cervelli jersey. Wearing a bow.
A gold ball, a yellow ball. I like that too. Look at that. They're just all happy.
Yeah.
Sitting in the laps.
Yeah.
That's what a dog's life.
Absolutely. That just
black and gold.
Loving every minute of it. Occasionally watching the game.
Do you think that, like, how many of the dogs out there tonight actually went to the beauty parlor yesterday to get ready for this night?
Probably more than half. Hit hard to center field. McCutcheon on his horse over his head. Panic will be held at third on the double by Brandon Belt. Second and third. No one out here in the fourth.
Not much. Cutcher's going to do about that when he ran down one earlier that was hit much higher, gave him some time to get back there. This one kind of a line drive. Ball hit very hard. Best Cutch could probably do on this one is what he did, turn around, try to get that rebound off the wall in as quick as he can. So now there's some work to be done. Nobody out, second and third.
And a golden opportunity for Buster Posey and the Giants as the Pirates will play their infield back. Pirates had a chance to score earlier against Cueto. First inning had a runner at third with one out. The Giants were conceding a run, but Cueto able to get a strike out of McCutcheon and get David Freese to ground out. Two and O on Buster Posey. Boscan, after that rough relief outing against the Angels on June the 3rd, optioned back to the minor leagues, and his first start with Indianapolis 6 days later did not go well at all. You see that on occasion. One of those kind of hangover outings, disappointed. Your option back down after being in the big leagues for over a month. And really a rough start for him against Columbus, the top farm club of the Indians. Gave up 7 runs in 1 2/3 and made a relief outing. And his last start was back to being the Boscan of old. 6 innings, 4 hits, no runs, no walks. That was 5 days ago. Swinging on the 3-0, it's 3-1.
Clemente.
Roberto Clemente.
Very nice.
Extremely clever.
I think that dog has a cannon for an arm. Can really go get him.
Mm-hmm. Run like a deer or like a greyhound in the dog's case. There's the first walk, and now they're loaded for Brandon Crawford. Bases loaded situation. Of course, you can't help but think back to the wild card game. Brandon Crawford came to the plate against Edinson Volquez. Bases loaded, and yep, fourth inning. Not much question, that was gone. And it left the bat, and not much question, the game was over after that swing. Madison Bumgarner and the Giants shut out the Bucks 8-0. That made it a 4-0 ball game. Three career regular season grand slams. Boscan looking for a ground ball from Crawford.
Yeah, right back to him. A little 1-2-3 double play.
He has hit into 7. Just tied for second most on the team.
One hopper back to the mound.
Drop untouched. Panic was ready to tag. 1-1. Game 2 of the 4-game series for the Giants. It's the 5th game of their road trip that started with a sweep down in St. Petersburg, Florida, against the Tampa Bay Rays. They'll head back home after this 4-game series that ends Thursday afternoon. Bouncing ball just foul. Ball 2-2. Boscan working hard here. Pivotal time in the game, of course. Can't afford to give up much when Cueto's your mound opponent. Two and two.
Down and away now to come. He hit right back to you. Going in.
Jacob Stallings behind the plate. A couple of rookies, Boscan and Stallings, as battery mates. Stallings' second career start behind the dish. Boscan's first start on a major league mound. Out of play, off speed.
Stallings that caught Tyone the other night, his third big league start.
Yeah.
Kind of used to this.
Jameson Tyone. And the brother-in-law, future brother-in-law for Brandon Crawford, Garrett Cole, who's still on the disabled list. Still 2-2. Line foul.
So I'm trying to come in on him.
Eighth pitch of this at bat.
Well, young hard throwers right there.
Oh, tried to get him to swing, did not. Now it's 3-2 on Brandon Crawford.
Went for the strikeout. took a little bit of a gamble here, putting that breaking ball in the dirt, thinking, okay, I'm gonna push my chips in. But now, since you didn't get the swing. Got to throw a strike.
Crawford has struck out 58 times. That's the most on the team. Boscan doesn't strike out many.
Well, way outside. Crawford chased after that. It was easily ball four. He ran.
Still 3-2. Giants strike out the least in the National League as a team. Another 3-2 pitch to Crawford. And another foul ball. This battle continues.
They got him to chase again.
Stallings wants to talk to Boscan. 10 pitches have been thrown to Brandon Crawford. No one out.
Good thing up to this point that Alfredo had been so efficient with his pitches. So he could afford to have an inning like this where maybe he has to work awfully hard.
On the DL, Hunter Pence on the left, and there's Jeff Samardzija. He will pitch tomorrow night against Francisco Liriano. It's Crawford for the Giants, Boscan for the Pirates. Nobody out, bases loaded. Here comes the 11th pitch of this at bat. Walked him, and it is 1-0 San Francisco. Give Crawford the RBI that brings home panic. Still nobody out.
Even though you walked in a run there with that battle, the 11 pitches, I mean, that, I don't think you can feel bad about that. You took a shot a couple of times at some strikeout pitches. You got the bases loaded. You surely just can't lay one into him. Cueto's pitching for them. You might not score many runs. So it's a tough spot to be in right there.
Mm-hmm. Right here, trying to give Boscan a bit of a breather, and the Pirates going to start loosening someone in their bullpen.
You got to, you know, also at this point right now, you got to turn the page from that tough at bat. You got to do the same thing. Got to repeat it now. Got another hitter stepping in there. It's the same situation. Nobody out, bases loaded. You got to go right back to making quality pitches. You can't dwell on what might have been, you know, when Crawford was up there.
Kimbe's Caminero loosens. Angel Pagan struck out in the second. And this one deep to center. And Pagan has hit a grand slam for the San Francisco Giants to give them a 5-0 lead in the fourth. His third home run. Angel Pagan.
He got a fastball. It was down for sure, but it was middle of the plate, not in or out at all.
Second career grand slam for Pagan.
Making it over, looked like had a seat in the second row.
And this ball hit toward the left center gap. Gregor Blanco into second with a double.
I don't know what happened out there. It had to be a little miscommunication between two outfielders. That shouldn't have been a double. This is not like a line drive into a gap. This is a kind of just a almost like a pop fly. And one of the two guys have to get that ball in the first hop.
Come on, Bobby, let go. Come on, come on. Go, go, come on.
Now Connor Gillespie.
Go fight.
Pagan, just his third home run, but second career granny. Missed some playing time, a couple different stretches this year with a left hamstring strain. Came off the disabled list last Tuesday.
Ready.
And these runs belong to Cueto, who's on deck. And no one out. And Gillespie drives one deep to right field. That is way out of here. Connor Gillespie. It's his second home run of the year. It is 7-0 Giants.
Pagan went the front row. This one goes in the back row.
That is going to be it for Wilfredo Boscan.
Similar spot. It was down knee high like the other home run, and like the other home run kind of in the middle part of the strike zone. There it is again. It's kind of a little bit of a tail, came right back down the middle. And Gillespie got all of that one as it got all the way back. Would have hit the fence, I believe, if it hadn't been knocked down by a fan.
It's time for the Toyota RAV 4th inning. The all-wheel drive RAV hybrid has performance that will make you rethink hybrid. Let's go, Bucks!
It is 7-0 Giants, a grand slam by Angel Pagan in this fourth inning, and then a two-run homer for Connor Gillespie, and Wilfredo Boscan gives way now to Arquímedes Caminero to face Johnny Cueto. Two and oh.
Caminero numbers on the year. A little bit of wildness sees battle this season.
Four straight scoreless appearances, however. wild. And look at Cueto.
I don't think Cueto will be like crowding the plate on this next pitch.
It's ball four, isn't it?
Yeah. Sign of a good hitter. He didn't want to take his base. We'll stay in there and swing the bat. Look at it. Tell me he wanted to hit. See something different every night.
And then to an art span.
Very aggressive.
He just walked. Cueto wasn't close. Two or three of those span swings at the first pitch, almost in the dirt.
Was in the dirt.
Brother.
Was in the dirt.
Was it in the dirt? Look at Cueto taking the lead. Jaso bounces over there to cover the bag.
Yeah, hold him on, so he's going to steal the base. Get off. Big lead. Now he's going back.
Still nobody out.
Tough night.
Two and two on span as Stallings blocks that pitch, and there's been a dance going on there at first base. Jaso backs off. Cueto start to take an aggressive lead. 2-2 on span. It was 0-2 against Boscan. ...32-year-old veteran from Washington D.C. Denard Span. Giants signed him as a free agent in January. Previous 3 years with the Nationals. Tough man to strike out. Ball bounced into the seats.
It's like a tough man to walk.
Yeah, that too. The middle and a base hit. Cueto headed to third and then put on the brakes.
What is he doing, Greg?
No idea.
It's 7-0. That's.
I mean, they're kind of laughing.
The same question was just asked right there.
I mean, this is your one of your aces.
Yeah.
Who? You want to talk about pulling a hamstring or a groin or anything along those lines, getting hurt? Leading 7-0. Jamming a thumb, diving back to the bag.
Jay, try to hit ball trick on it.
I think so.
It's kind of like that. That's an infielder's version of the quick pitch.
Yeah.
On, getting back. Let's see what Jay Hay potentially throw it in. Cueto saw.
Yeah. Now 2-1 on Joe Panic, who started this whole thing. A soft single to center field. Brandon Belt doubled over Andrew McCutchen's head. Buster Posey walked, so did Brandon Crawford. Angel Pagan hit the grand slam. Hit to center, McCutchen. As Cueto will tag. One out. Bruce Bochy.
I think she's got Bartolo Colon out there on the bases. He wants to score.
Yep, cheering on Holler. Brandon Belt.
Belt. Some encouragement.
Tapper. 4-6-3. A 7-run fourth inning. Pagan, Granny, Gillespie, 2-run homer. Now for our Lowe's home field advantage. In PNC Park history, Andrew McCutchen, the all-time leader in all of these categories. 550 career games. Hits, doubles, triples, home runs, RBIs, runs scored. Tonight is 551st game played here at PNC Park. Lowe's home field advantage. And he will lead off. Pirates. A mountain to climb now, down 7.
Got to start now with a tired Cueto.
Yes. Home runs, Pagan, Gillespie. Still fired up.
Sun is setting, Greg. Get those final reflections.
Hey. First pitch strike. So McCutchen was struck out in the first. And now 0-2. No early signs that Cueto is tired. Oh. three-pitch strikeout. It's Cueto's fourth.
Maybe he's not that tired. Thought he'd be a little winded after his antics on the bases. Loft played away, a little chase.
Bob, did you ever do that when you were pitching? Did you ever try just doing a little Louis Tiant?
No, but I did the quick pitch. I like doing that.
How'd that work?
Fine.
Yeah.
That was never a big deal. The only thing I ever worried about was I did it out of the windup. But all I did was just step and throw. I didn't do, there was no turn at all. So I was a little worried at times.
You see that little shake, rattle, and roll there from Cueto.
When I would do it, Greg. Kind of the double shimmy.
Yeah, you didn't do that.
No, I didn't do that. But I always looked in for the sign with my with the ball in my glove. And when I did a quick pitch, I had to have the ball in my hand because I didn't want to take time to reach in there. I just wanted to step and throw. So I always wondered, were the hitters looking at me, noticing that I had the ball in my hand instead of my glove, and was just going to quick pitch, step and throw. That was all. I was always like paranoid about that. But then I kind of, after a while and looking back, hitters probably aren't that, they're not observing that sort of thing. But even when Cueto does a quick pitch, it's abbreviated windup. Yeah. It's not just step and throw. But heck, I mean, how many times do I say your job out there is to mess up the
timing of the hitter?
Timing of the hitter. So why shouldn't you use your delivery to add to that? It's a little bit of an old school thing, but as you can see by Cueto, it'll still work. And nowadays, the modern view is that you have to have such a repeatable delivery.
Yeah, I was just going to say.
Everything has to be just a mirror image of the delivery before. It's all about mechanics. But if you're athletic enough, you can do anything you want out there. Wainwright, He used to sometimes go up over his head. He would change. He would go back and forth one side of the rubber to the other at times. And I always thought, wow, that's a little bit of a throwback thing. But that's really been out of favor, I think, especially with pitching coaches for a number of years.
You need that repeatable delivery to help with command.
Well, when I was young, I can remember first time I tried to throw a couple pitches side on just in the bullpen, and Rube Walker was pitching coach. It was 1981 with the Braves, and he said, what are you doing? And I said, well, just, you know, I was going to try drop it down every now and then, they'll different look. And he's like, no, you're not. But then as I got older and got to the point where I could do what I wanted, that became a very big part of what I was out there doing. I would drop down a couple times an inning.
There comes a certain point where you get the status, you can do whatever you want, essentially,
well,
right?
Or you get released, and then you realize
anything you,
before I'm at home permanently, I'm going to try this the way I want to. And that was a big eye opener for me too, getting released, thinking, well, I'm going to try some different things now.
Josh Harrison struck out in the second. First two men struck out here in the fourth before the Marte free pass. And Starling Marte, that is the sixth time this season he has walked unintentionally. Just some stuff is baseball, just so crazy. Here's a guy throwing all these strikes, Cueto, and he walks Marte, and then almost immediately gets Harrison to pop out to end the inning. phenomenal. Kevin Pillar, the Blue Jays game going on a full slate as Arizona leads that interleague contest. The Rockies in front of the Yankees 5-2 in the fifth. Baltimore hosting San Diego leads it 2-1 as Buster Posey lifts one deep to center field. And McCutchen back.
Oh!
And cannot make that catch. Be a double for Buster Posey.
Like right there, he might have a beat on it, but ball hit right on the 57.
Brandon Crawford now walked with the bases loaded in the fourth. Buster Posey on base for a second time, his 15th double.
Tough one right now. How much you can do right now as far as managing. You just got to hope the players stop the bleeding and the offense can get you back in the game.
Tomorrow it's Francisco Liriano that's starting pitching. Just can't seem to put a string of strong starts together. Hard hit at the shortstop Mercer. One out. So Thursday afternoon this series will conclude, and Garrett Cole bobbleheads given away to the first 20,000 fans, brought to you by Peoples. Go to pirates.com for tickets. The Garrett Cole bobbleheads to the first 20,000 fans on Thursday afternoon.
Infield down. In tight, edge of the grass, gotta choke off every run now.
Strike the count on Pagan.
Nice movement on that last pitch, the way it had that cut action. Start on the outside corner and brought it in.
To third. And that runner holds.
Nicely done. Why you bring that infield in on the grass? Hope you get that ground ball right at somebody. Don't have much time to move left or right when you're playing that close, so it's got to be pretty much at you.
Pair of doubles for Gregor Blanco.
Way inside, looked like Blanco thought or knew that was coming inside. He backed away before the ball was released.
Ball and one strike. On the veteran outfielder. Sure.
Forkball.
Hey. 2-2.
That is the splitter. It's got that little short slider cutter action going. And normally the splitter will go down and away, but sometimes you'll release it in a fashion that'll actually cut for you.
You remember how effective that pitch was for him for a time last year, Bob?
You know who else used to do that a lot? Was Samardzija. Was with the Cubs. He would throw that pitch and it would look just like a really good hard slider. The way it would cut, break down and in the lefties or down away to righties. Unless Pagan was wrong about what he was swinging at. You always trust those hitters.
Well, ultimately isn't what the pitcher thinks it is. It's what it,
no, absolutely. I mean,
whatever Caminero says he threw, right, regardless of what anybody else wants to call it.
Call it the solvent pitch.
The portfolio pitch, I call it, Bob.
Well, that's what you have. All your pitches are in your portfolio.
No question.
Where's the, that's good. Yeah. What is the pitcher's portfolio?
Yeah.
Well, he's got fastball, he's got slider. Good one, Greg. I like it.
I think the better the portfolio, the more leverage he has.
Yeah. Well, if you have a nice, solid portfolio of pitches, you'll probably stay solvent.
Ball four on Blanco, and now Caminero will face Cole Gillespie. With a two run homer last inning off of Boscan. Gillespie starting at third base tonight. Last night it was Romero Pena. As Matt Duffy went on the disabled list with a left Achilles strain. We talked about that earlier, that that ends his consecutive games played streak at 188. That was leading the major leagues. Pirates record for games played for a time was a National League record. Set by Gus Sir, who played in a then National League record 822 consecutive games. And off the glove of Harrison, another run in, and motoring to third Blanco, and it is 8-0 San Francisco.
Too hard for Jay Hay to come up with it. Did Jason Bay have a long string for the Pirates?
He did
at one point.
Yeah.
Not as long as Gus.
Obviously not. Yeah.
But I thought he had a decent run at complete game string going.
Gus Sir, the all-time games played record at first base in Pirates history. Played with the Pirates from 1930 to 1939. The man who broke his National League record games played was none other than Stan Musial.
Pretty good player.
Denora, Pennsylvania's own Stan the Man. Broke the record June 12, 1957. Record that had been set by the Pirates, Gus Sir. Right field, Polanco is right there, and Giants add to the lead. The base hit by Gillespie, 8-0.
question is from Kim. She wants to know, what is your favorite snack or food that you like to eat either before or after a game?
I got a lot of snack foods. You know, I think one of my favorite snack foods on the plane when we fly is peanut M&Ms. I'm a sucker for peanut M&Ms. Really like those. And then pregame, our chef Tony and Vic, they do a great job of mixing it up, and so nothing gets too old, and they like to spice it up sometimes, and so I think it's kind of cool to try some new things.
So Greg and Bob, it's been a couple years since I've been on the Pirates charter. How are those peanut M&Ms? Or actually, what are your favorite snacks on the plane?
Well, ask Robbie, and Robbie knows all about that. I don't know, are there any left by the time they get back to the guys Mercer?
Snack tray doesn't pass Robbie's row.
We're not sure what they have on the plane anymore. We get nothing.
Not sure about that. What do you like to like on your announcer day? You stay away from like peanuts and stuff, don't you?
And that's just my announcer day. What does that mean?
Well, every day. I don't know what that meant. Yeah, that was like. It was kind of like pitching, you know, you'd have your day of pitching, but I guess it doesn't announce. But don't you try to stay away from like peanuts?
Not really. Do you stay away from creme brulee?
Doesn't like get you like something in your throat?
Do you stay away from creme brulee?
Before the game, yeah. You won't see me having a dish of creme brulee before the game. That's only a late night luxury item.
Try to stay away from garlic and onion before a game, before an announcer
day. There was something before an announcer day.
Not easy to do.
No garlic. Aren't you afraid of vampires or anything like that? You don't have any garlic.
Not before a game, but just like you, creme brulee after the game, garlic.
Chicken wings after the game is good too. I like chicken wings.
Any particular snacks the dogs stay away from before or after the game?
They do like some milk bones before the game.
Uh-huh.
So they're not real hungry as the game goes along, because they want to watch the game. They don't want to eat too much.
Picked up by Gillespie. Retires Stallings. A line out to left, a ground out to third, and now Jung Ho Gang will pinch hit for Caminero.
A healer.
Now the pierogies are not allowed on the party deck with the pups.
No, dogs will snatch up a pierogi in a second if you leave it unattended.
You'll never see the pierogies up there.
No, they stay away from them. Chicken wings, Greg. Can we go up there right now?
Sure.
Grab a bucket real quick.
Yep.
That's my favorite place here in the stadium. If I had to go eat, right there. That's it. One of them some tall drinks they sell here. Nice comfortable seat.
Oh and two on Gang.
No garlic wings though for you.
Or onion wings. Or onion
they
rings.
Don't have onion wings.
They have onion rings. Gang is retired. 1-2-3 and Cueto. A breeze. 8-0.
Pirates Baseball on Root Sports is brought to you by the Chevy Trax and your Western PA Chevy dealers. And by Barrel. With express service, you're in and out in no time. Visit barrelservice.com to find the location near you. Let's go, Bucks!
It is 8-0. Giants lead it. Grand slam, two-run homer. The big blows. Well, they played a home run derby, minor league A-ball on the Midway. And MLB.com was there to cover it. Nothing petty about Storm Baseball's Midway Classic. Kyle Petty, not the racer, won that home run derby in San Diego. He's, I believe, a Seattle Mariners prospect from that organization in Bakersfield, first baseman for the Mariners. Beat out an Orioles prospect, Adeline Rodriguez. How much fun would that be, Bob?
Oh, they were launching balls off there like a steam catapult.
That took place.
There's some Jolly Rogers on the Midway.
Yeah.
We've seen that before.
He had 22 home runs in the Midway Classic. It's a home run derby between the Single A California League and the Carolina League.
To home run? You hit it off the boat?
I don't know the official rules of the
Midway Classic. It didn't look like the fence was all that far away. I'm sure there were
buoys in the water that marked the home run territory. Nice. There were fans on jet skis, boats, kayaks. They patrolled the ocean, scooped up the baseballs.
Had to have something like that. That had to be a lot of fun for them. For everybody involved in that, just to watch it, to participate in it.
Petty was drafted out of California University of Pennsylvania 3 years ago as a senior.
Really?
How about that?
Nice.
Cal U product. I know Jason Steele likes that. Our associate producer, Cal U. Schugel strikes out Denard Span.
Span chasing one out of the zone.
Bucko fans, 2016 Esurance MLB All-Star ballot is here. Head to Pirates.com, choose your hashtag ASG worthy stars, send them to the Major League Baseball All-Star game in San Diego. Presented by MasterCard, July the 12th in San Diego. Vote today, vote tomorrow, vote at Pirates.com/vote.
Imagine there'll be a few things going on baseball related on the Midway between now and the All-Star game. Some board, right? Maybe what, two blocks from the stadium? It's really a great place to have a baseball trip, San Diego. Yeah. A lot of stuff to do there. Beautiful ballpark.
Home run derby that took place yesterday. A ball. There's the diagram of the Midway Classic home run derby.
Wow, you had to hit it 500 feet.
That's the.
I guess because you're up in the air, they had to move the fence back.
Yeah, that's right.
Kind of like Coors Field. You got to move the fences back.
Balls retrieved by volunteers on jet skis and kayaks.
It'd be great.
What can we do here? How can we use the bridges and the river for anything the next time the All-Star game is here? You got to come up with something.
I already got it. Right in the very center of the Clemente Bridge.
Yeah.
You build an elevated platform with center field basically being downriver toward the point. And you have your buoys downriver. And so that you can
you can hit the home runs. That's fair ball.
Yeah, it is. They'll challenge this, and that'll be overturned. Question's going to be, where are they going to put Belt? They're going to challenge it, but where do you put Brandon Belt? If you're
around your waist.
If you're very good. If you're in New York and you have to tell these umpires, where are you going to put them? You got Marte hustling in to get the ball.
Well, I think he would have had a single there, but I think they'll give him a double. But if that would have been called fair, I think that would have been a single. You know, I'm not sure. I'd want to see a wide angle and see where Marte was. That's what I
think
they'll
look at.
They'll look and they'll see where Marte was.
And where Belt was.
Well, was he running hard? Yeah. Was he standing there? That's good. Yeah. They'll take everything into consideration and decide. But definitely saw a little chalk bounce up in the air as that ball hit.
Shouldn't take but a few seconds. I'm surprised it's taken this long. And maybe they're looking at the different angles.
Yeah, that might be what's taking so long, is figuring out where they're going to put him.
Where to put him. Let's see Belt. Where will they put him? Phelan Colbreth, the crew chief and the home plate umpire, and C.B. Bucknor, third base umpire who called it, have the headsets on. He called it foul. Giants are challenging. They say it's fair, and it is. Fair ball, and he's going to second.
Second base.
And Marte's going, wait a second, there's no way he'd go to second base.
But did they make him touch first right there on his way to second?
I don't know. Or he just did
like
that on his own.
It looked like they made him. Well, maybe did do it on his own.
Belt's second double of the ball game.
Here, we'll get a good look to see where Marte was there. Boy, I don't know, Greg.
I don't either.
I mean, it would have been a.
Nothing automatic about it,
no,
obviously.
You know what? I'm still sticking with it. I think he would have got a single. I'm sticking with my first impression, single. But I do understand why they put him in second. Marte is just a little different animal out there with that arm of his. What do you think about my idea for the
now, you're
going
to have to explain
like
it again. I'm sorry. I was caught up in the foul and the fair.
Well, put one.
Sorry. So explain it once again.
No,
to
I'm
us.
Not. It's
you two, have to.
2 outs. Foul tip. I like this view also. You like that view?
Yeah, but I want to know what your home run derby is going to be.
All right.
An elevated platform in the middle of the Clemente Bridge. Correct.
It's got to be right in the center of the bridge.
Right, that's what I said.
The very center of the bridge.
Center of the bridge.
I think that's the left edge of the bridge.
Well, we may not be able to get the exact shot at the center. Look out. Roberto Kelly, third base coach, has to duck out of the way. Can you tell us straight for us, maybe?
Absolutely.
Oh, there we go.
Not the center of the bridge. That's like one of the big pillars.
Yeah.
It's got to go to the right. I don't know if
it might not, be able
it might not
that
go
shot.
That far.
Oh,
to the
there
right.
we go.
Oh, there we go. Yeah.
So we're getting the idea.
There's the center of the bridge.
All right.
There we go.
So in the center, an elevated platform.
Perfect.
A fly ball, shallow center. That's going to drop in for a hit. Buster Posey with an RBI to make it 9-0. Posey's on base for a third straight time as Belt scores from second.
Didn't hit it all that hard. I got out on the end of the bat, a little breaking ball.
Maybe third RBI for Posey. Giants fans happy. Here's Brandon Crawford.
trying to get Jaso's attention as my time was called. I wanted to play behind the runner here, 9-0.
Strike on Crawford. Bases loaded walk in the fourth.
Platform right there that you're standing on. You got a cage and you're hitting the ball out this way. Here's your you get your buoys out here.
Right.
There's your home run hit contest. What do you think? No, yeah, you don't like
it. I mean, I thought you were coming up with some great idea. I mean, that's
you got your elevated platform.
Yeah, to me, that's your idea. Platform.
Here you go. There's your fair territory.
Brilliant. An elevated platform.
Yeah.
You're just copying off the Midway Classic.
Well, it's a bridge. There's not a lot you can do with it. It's not like you got an aircraft carrier out here in the Alligator.
There's a base hit for Crawford. First and second. What about a barge at the confluence over by the Ohio, right at the point? You got wider river there.
How about this?
Or how about right from the point, where you don't even have to use a barge? Look at this, Bob.
You're talking about hitting.
Yeah.
Hitting out into here.
Oh man, now you're
talking.
There's
your home run hitting contest out that way. I like that, Greg.
Thank you.
I like that a lot.
About that, Bob. Now Steve is going. What are you guys doing?
I wonder if Steve has likes that idea.
Steve says you're being silly.
That could be for the pitcher's home run hitting contest.
Are you aware that Steve was not thrilled with the idea? The pitchers didn't like.
Oh, he wasn't. What could we do with that?
The convention center. I'm not sure you could do much.
Hey, I got an idea though for the barge site.
One-handed swing and a fly ball to right.
Save it for later.
Another run in. 9-0. Giants. Coverage of baseball brought to you by T-Mobile. We check out some scores. The Cardinals, who beat the Cubs last night, held on for a victory, leading 4-2 in the bottom of the third. That is Adam Wainwright on the hill for St. Louis. The Marlins shutting out Atlanta 2-0. Mets have a 2-1 lead against the Royals in the sixth. Dodgers tonight against the Washington Nationals. Just a handful of a busy Tuesday night in Major League Baseball. Scott Kazmir against Tanner Roark, the pitching matchup for the Washington Nationals and the Los Angeles Dodgers. Jarrett Parker takes over in left. Angel Pagan, who had a grand slam out of the ballgame. Brandon Crawford leaves in favor of Ramiro Pena. Johnny Cueto faces John Jaso. Crawford a hit and three official trips plus a bases loaded walk. Game got away in the fourth from Wilfredo Boscan, who pitched three scoreless innings. His first big league start, retired the first six men he faced, then gave up a leadoff double to Gregor Blanco before retiring the next three. Did not record an out in the fourth.
He was very efficient with his pitches those first three innings. Hitting spots, throwing strikes. Just unraveled on him.
New pitcher for the Bucks is going to be Jorge Rondon. His second Pirate appearance. Jaso led off the bottom of the first inning with a double. Looked promising. Gregory Polanco had a one hopper to second that moved Jaso to third, but Cueto struck out Andrew McCutchen, got David Freese to bounce out. In the air to center, Span. Just two hits against Cueto. Well, the Nissan Road Ahead. It is Jeff Samardzija tomorrow against Francisco Liriano Thursday afternoon. John Neese for the Pirates against Albert Suarez, the rookie, in his 10th appearance and fourth start. Francisco Liriano, 4-1, a 3.07 ERA and five career starts against the Giants. Hit aside from the Jaso double in the first, a two out single by Jordy Mercer in the second. Giants signing Cueto to that 6-year deal, and again the opt out after 2 years if he so chooses. A 6-year, $130 million deal, more than Arizona had offered. Diamondbacks 6-year, $120 million deal. Cueto turned that down and later signed with San Francisco. Shallow right. A one-out single for Polanco.
Being down 9-0 just limits so many things you can do. Closer ball game, you could use the running game perhaps a little bit to get Cueto, shake him up a little. Well, he's not quick pitching, he's rather slow to the plate. But 9-0, the running game gets called off.
Struck out Andrew McCutchen in both of his at bats. Hey. two strikes. Guido has struck out five batters. Eric Kratz, the veteran, and rookie Jacob Stallings.
Kind of neat. Kratz, Stallings sitting there together. Kratz been around a long, long time. Seen an awful lot in this game. Stallings just getting his career going. Smart thing, ask as many questions as you can.
Remains 2-2 on McCutcheon. How about the bare hand play by the ball girl down the line last night? Did you see that?
Yeah, fantastic.
That was all
play.
Over Twitter and social media.
I mean, we've bragged on them for years. Yeah. I mean, we know that they're the best.
Yeah. But bare hand, my goodness.
Sometimes the ball takes a bad hop. You got to make an adjustment. Only other player I ever seen to really do that in action was Ozzie Smith would make that play sometimes. Bad hop, he could adjust with the bare hand.
Yeah, yeah. Here's the play. Look at Mike Breen behind her. Good buddy Mike Breen sees it take it older. He thought he was going to have a souvenir. It's his daughter next to him, I believe. And great play. Kevin Mitchell also, right? The bare hand.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, outfield. Mm-hmm.
When he was with the Giants.
Wasn't necessarily a bad hop. He just decided it looked like I'm gonna catch this with the bare hand. Yeah.
Mike Breen, the Pirate season ticket holder. I clearly had it lined up. Ball girl makes a great bare hand and snag the MLB. Blaze Laboon down there tonight. Strike three called. McCutcheon's struggles just continue.
Just catches that inside corner.
To Span and center. We'll do it for the Pirates. Six innings complete. 9-0 Giants.
And our final question for Jordy Mercer here on Twitter Tuesday comes from Bob. How many different fielding gloves have you used during the span of your major league career?
I've only used two gloves throughout my minor league and major league career. And my first year in minor leagues was the same glove I used in college. And then I got a new one the year after that, and I've used that one ever since. So since 2009, I've had the same glove.
And that includes using glue, staples, stitches, anything to keep it together, because you guys know as well as I do, that thing's falling apart.
Yeah, you get a favorite one like that, you got to do everything you can to keep it together. Hopefully you have a Bob Patterson on the team that can give you some repairs.
Bullet Bob, the former.
Yep, he used to take care of everybody's gloves.
Gregory Polanco has moved from right to left. Starling Marte goes from left to center. Matt Joyce now the ball game playing right field for the Bucs, and he will bat in the ninth spot of the order. So Andrew McCutchen out of there, and Jorge Rondon will make his second Pirate appearance. Last year, Rondon played with the Rockies and Orioles, made 10 relief appearances in the big leagues combined.
Rondon's numbers, just a couple of innings there.
191 ERA in AAA Indianapolis this season.
Tough one for Ray. He was at home last night. Didn't see the 1-0 game.
No. Comes out and sees this one.
Yeah.
Picked the wrong night.
Right.
And a sore back. Sore wrist. 3-0 on Gregory Polanco.
I'm sure he was still very proud of Jeff Locke bouncing back after two just horrible starts to. They pitch a gem in last night's game.
Four pitch walk to Polanco. Yep. Jeff Locke, no walks in 6 2/3. Connor Gillespie now. Giants and Bucks. Last night the Pirates beat the Giants. Tonight the Giants went on their way to evening this series.
You never know. Every night you come to the game, how it's going to turn out.
Line off the glove. Jordy Mercer. Connor Gillespie with his third straight hit. Network Supermo.
Actually kind of looked like the spin was bringing it back toward Mercer. Didn't break down to him quite enough.
But Johnny Cueto will bat. Line to right his last time up. Misses. Now the runner thought that he was out, and
yeah.
Now he wanders off the bag. Cole Gillespie.
Makes me think he was tagged.
Exactly right. The umpire said no tag, but Gillespie's reaction makes you think he felt something. At least thought he was out.
Yeah, he did.
Yep, yeah, slipped him on the elbow.
Manny
Gonzalez, the umpire, called him safe, but then not knowing the call, Gillespie wandered off the bag, figuring he was out. I was surprised to see the throw from Jaso back to Mercer. Cueto says stay there.
Tell you, Cueto is here to play tonight.
Yeah, he is.
Isn't he?
Yep. Yep.
You gotta give that to him, man. He is into the ball game, running the bases, hitting whatever.
He really is. The Pirates are gonna challenge it.
They will win this one. Right there.
Again, the crew chief fielding Colbert and the umpire who made the call, Manny Gonzalez. Pirates infield gathered around Cole Gillespie. Johnny Cueto tapped that ball to Harrison. Will be retired on a 4-6-3 double play. Gregor Blanco will be at third base with two outs.
Why is this one taking so long, Rick?
They want to be certain. You've got to get these calls right.
We obviously saw that right away.
But they're going to be absolutely certain.
Oh, I am absolutely certain that he was out.
Just want to see every angle.
Make sure. Only needed to see one angle.
Now, they might see something different in New York. Just get every call absolutely right. And
he's out.
Yep. So the call overturned. And it is a 4-6-3 double play.
Nice play by Jehe. Coming in, charging that ball hard enough to tag on the arm.
Two minutes, 6 seconds, that review. Denard Span at the plate with the runner at third. Span singled off of Arquímedes Caminero in the fourth, was 0-for-2 against the starter Boscon, and struck out against Schugel. Jorge Rondon, second appearance for the Pirates. Walked Blanco to start the inning. And the Gillespie base hit, and now Cueto, after bouncing into the double play, will be heading out to the mound for the bottom of the seventh and looking surefire lock to go 11-1. His first 12 giant decisions. And he would be the first Giants pitcher with 11 wins in his first 15 starts. This is his 15th start tonight. First Giants pitcher with 11 wins in his first 15 starts since Rick Rushel did it in 1989. Big Daddy finished 17-8 that year after a 19 win season the previous campaign, and there's a base hit for Span and a 10 spot on the board. Two hits in the inning, another run, and Joe Panic comes up. 14 hits for the Giants. I did not realize, Bob, that Big Daddy won 19 games the year after he was traded that summer of 87 for what, Jeff Robinson and
Don
who else?
Robinson, I think.
Was it Don? No, it was Jeff Robinson and Scott Medvin.
No.
In August of 1987.
Donnie went to the Giants that same year.
I think so. Was that the
I forgot.
Mm-hmm. Now you got it. Gets away from Stallings. The runner will move up.
That's a, one of the things that fastballs in the dirt, right? Where does that come? Look where that one hit.
Yeah.
That was a fastball that hit what, about a foot out in front of home plate. That I don't get that nowadays. You see them.
It happens more than it should, right?
Oh, it's extremely rare. Years ago, back in, well, I don't think Big Daddy, who had a great sinker, bounced a lot of fastballs.
English on that one, so Mercer guns it to get panic. Another run in.
Nation, the sounds, the sights, brought to you by the Allegheny Health Network. Supermo, and it's not a real pleasant sight there. 10-0.
Bad looking scoreboard tonight.
Starling Marte struck out and walked. So again, he's going to become the first Giant since Rick Rushel to go 11-1 in his first 15 starts. Rushel did it in 1989. That was his second full year with the Giants. Pirates had traded him in the summer of 87 to San Francisco, and 88 he won 19 games. One away. And just a reminder, Miller time. Look forward to that later in today's game. Grab a cold one. Anyway, so
sure you will.
So Rick Rushel, I didn't realize, had been named to the All-Star game in the summer of 88.
He was going to the All-Star game, yep. And then I think he got married during the All-Star break, something like that. I can't remember exactly, but I think that's what it was.
Rodriguez hit by the pitch and not real happy.
But anyway, because Rick bowed out, and had something to do on the All-Star break that he couldn't attend the All-Star game, they had to go to their backup plan B list. I happened to be on that plan B list.
How about that?
So I got a phone call. I got a phone call that day of the last game before the All-Star break saying that, you know, instead of going home, you're going to end up going to Cincinnati. So because of Rick Rushel, I got to be an All-Star for the one and only time in my
life. Pretty cool story.
So thank you, Big Daddy. If you're listening tonight, I really appreciated that. What year was it? Was the earthquake series? Was that 89?
I think so. Yeah. Yeah.
Rick Rushel, a huge part of getting the Giants to the World Series. Definitely a trade that worked out for him. And worked out at Jeff Robinson.
Yeah.
Was a darn good pitcher for the Pirates.
Buster Posey throws out Mercer. Dog days of summer are here.
Yeah, it looks like some of the doggies are starting to thin out up there a little bit. They've got their bedtime. Time to get home.
Oh, I don't like that. I don't think that was very friendly.
What we dash just saw. Down.
Yeah. That was not just a friendly hello, goodbye. You talk about the cats maybe not getting along. What about these guys?
I think he picked the wrong guy to bite, too.
Yeah, he did. Yeah, don't mess with him.
He's just a teddy bear. Look like Butch. One of the best dogs we ever had. Butch.
Yeah.
Look very similar.
Looks like this is going to be it for Cueto, winding down his night. 101 pitches, and Bruce Bochy gets the bullpen working. Jacob Stallings. Need to break the shutout bid. Bucko Javi Lopez. Celebrating a birthday today, 1 year today. Caden James Graham, our associate director, Tyler Graham's son. Happy birthday, Caden.
Absolutely, happy birthday.
Celebrating the same day as Garrett Jones, GI, 35 today. How about that? Garrett Jones playing in Japan. Two and two on Jacob Stallings. Line to left, and Jacob Stallings is going to have his first major league hit. It's going to be an RBI double.
That's a nice one to get right there. I know that the game is obviously out of hand and everything, but you got to feel good about that one. You get an RBI, you got an extra base hit driving it over the left fielder's head, and you got it off Cueto. I mean, that. It'll be nice to say when somebody asks you years later who's getting the first hit off of. Everybody knows Johnny Cueto. Definitely won the cheapie.
Great to see for Jacob Stallings. No, that's for sure. No, a no doubter. His seventh major league at bat is an RBI double.
And he'll be able to say, and I knocked Cueto out of the game.
Yeah.
Gotta have that right.
Pirate bench.
Want to make sure they get that ball in.
Pitt basketball coach on hand to see his son pick up his first major league hit. A double off Johnny Cueto. Matt Joyce his first at bat and facing Javier Lopez.
Had to be a thrill for him. Like I said, to add a little extra to it, you knock Cueto out of the game. When he was throwing a shutout, I mean, you could add all kinds of stuff to this story.
And this is true. This is a true story too.
Yeah,
no embellishment.
Absolutely. Javier Lopez been around for quite a while. See his numbers this year.
Lopez his sixth full year with the Giants. He's coming over in a deal from the Pirates in 2010. Bucks had signed him as a free agent for the 2010 campaign. Turned 39 in less than a month.
As long as you get lefties out, some teams will have that specialist spot for you. Occasionally you see those lefties pitch up into their 40s.
Johnny Cueto rooting him on. That's his run at second base. Came in with an ERA of 2.10, sixth lowest in the league. Looks a little like Kevin Ory, doesn't he? I just realized that. Kevin Ory, those the
green league. Absolutely. Look,
Javi Lopez.
Yeah, there's low resemblance there.
He walks Joyce.
First baseman, John Jason.
Old blue eyes.
Pittsburgh's his kind of town.
There you go. Yeah, we were talking about what they eat.
Yeah.
But there you go. Some of that dog food from Rachel Ray, is that her name?
I don't know. I mean, yeah, there is someone named Rachel Ray. I assume that's the dog food there.
Yeah, I think so.
Right, yeah. Terry, the cameraman.
Don't bite the hand that feeds you.
That's right, but he's actually feeding the dog as he takes the shot. I think that's a first. We've never seen that on a Pirate game.
At a ballpark anywhere.
Yeah, that's right. Never before have we seen cameraman take that shot
while feeding a dog.
The dog at the same time. Great work. It's pretty good.
Might have to make a stop before he gets in the car.
Count. Back to back walks. Dave Rigetti going to make a visit. There's a third straight left-handed batter. Gregory Polanco will be coming up. Cricket gives us something to smile about. A look at tonight's attendance, 27,729. Game two of the four-game series. Something to smile about. Good treats.
From now on the pup nights, when we give the attendance, we also should give the dog attendance at the bottom there, along with. You know, I'm curious how many dogs we had here tonight.
Would Terry or someone out there give us an idea? But even one of the dog owners. No, they were. I'm talking about the dog owners. No.
Oh, they did.
Yeah, they've been out there all night. It was just
an estimate.
A guess.
Kind of like a home run distance.
Yeah, that's right.
Guess.
Statcast. At least 100 plus dogs were told. Apparently, he said at least 101 Dalmatians. And
that's a good dog right there.
What is that? Rat terrier, beagle?
That's more beagle looking than anything else. You know, you should know your dogs better than you do, being a dog owner yourself.
I said, is that a rat terrier or a beagle? I had both.
Well, yeah, but I don't see the resemblance of a rat terrier.
Oh, I do.
You do?
Yeah. Don't get me started, Bob.
Why not? I would like to get you started.
Oh, that is pretty incredible. That was called a strike.
That's a smidgen low.
You think? A smidgen low?
Yeah.
How about that low? Goodness. My goodness gracious. Smidgen, Bob?
Smidgen.
He's got to swing at anything now.
Yeah, he had to swing at it.
Yeah, that wasn't a strike. Flies out to right.
Pirates Baseball on Root Sports is brought to you by Kenny Ross, Total Confidence Pricing, and by Levin Furniture, the official furniture and mattress supplier to the Pittsburgh Pirates. For the best quality, service, and value, shop Levin's. Let's go, Bucks!
10-0, head to the eighth inning, the site of a future home run derby. Roberto Clemente Bridge. Sean Rodriguez, who pinch hit for Josh Harrison, stays in the game, is at second. One ball game. One bright spot. His son, his first major league hit. It was an RBI double, broke up the shutout bid. Brandon Belt takes a strike. Cueto, 6 2/3, one run, four hits, a walk, and six strikeouts. Belt with a couple of doubles. A 7-run fourth inning. Wilfredo Boscan making his first major league start for the Pirates. Three shutout frames, and then Joe Panic led off with a hit. Brandon Belt doubled him to third. Buster Posey walked to load the bases. Brandon Crawford followed with a free pass. Angel Pagan grand slam, and after Gregor Blanco double, Cole Gillespie, you just saw him in the dugout, hit his second home run of the season. And the strikeout. Some tweets regarding Jacob Stallings' first hit. Congrats, Stallings. Way to get it done. Hopefully that's the first of many to come. Jim tweets out, pretty cool witnessing the Stallings family and friends celebrate Jacob's first major league hit. And Donnie, congrats to Jacob Stallings on his first major league hit and RBI. I understand that Mike Fox, his college coach at UNC, was also among the group in the stands witnessing the first big league hit. They're checking out the tweets. Probably pretty cool for Jacob Stallings to be catching and behind the plate with Buster Posey at the plate. Considered one of the top catchers certainly in the game.
They're both two-way catcher too. I mean, throwing out over 50% of the base stealers this year.
The MVP in 2012. Series champions 2010, 2012, 2014. Three-time Silver Slugger, the comeback player of the year in 2012. Rookie of the year in 2010. And a rule named after him. The Buster Posey rule. And Rendon gets the strikeout. Two away, we'll bring up Ramiro Pena. This Friday is a free shirt Friday. Pirates Dodgers, first of a four-game series. First 20,000 fans get a free Jung Ho Gong t-shirt presented by AAA Auto Insurance. Go to pirates.com/free shirt Friday. Jung Ho Gong appears to be in the starting lineup tomorrow. Clayton Kershaw would be scheduled to start on Saturday. He won his 11th game last night. Go, 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 go. Dodgers have not announced their rotation. They have the travel day on Thursday. Hit well by Pena. Marte back. And Pena gonna get a triple out of it.
Looks like Marte might have hurt his ankle or something.
That's been an issue with him at times this season.
Limping on it now, and it, it took him a little while to get over to that ball.
And here comes Clint Hurdle. Take the long walk out there. Ben Potenziano, assistant trainer.
This is a left leg, right? I didn't see anything on that first look, did you, Greg?
I did not. See anything there. Looked like initially went after it all right, but then. See here, maybe. See anything here? Bit of a turn there.
This is his right or his left? I thought it was his left. It's his right.
He missed a few starts. Well, recently had that ball come up.
Yeah, that one got him in the
cheek.
Yeah. That is a
get out of the ball game.
Swell up.
Yeah. Marte's going to leave.
Kind of a long walk.
Yeah, it is.
From center field.
Marte had left ankle discomfort earlier this month.
I think he's favoring his left.
And so, how about this? Eric Kratz going to head to first. Jason going to play some outfield.
Yeah. He's got the big glove on.
Who's going to play center? Sean Rodriguez played some center earlier this season. Maybe Polanco will go to center. Clint Hurdle kind of directing traffic, telling which player to go where. Jordy Mercer is asking, please, I'd like to play some center.
Raise his hand up.
Yeah. How about me? Let me play the outfield.
Nobody has gone the right yet. I'm guessing that's where Jaso's going. Oh, he's hopping on it now. Well, that's not good, Greg. Do something to it that he's going to miss any significant time.
Jaso out and right for the first time this season. Polanco in center. Joyce moves to left. And batter Jarrett Parker. First at bat tonight. He was 1-for-3 in last night's ball game.
Everybody's got their own little style, you know, when they get into the batter's box. That's the way Parker holds the bat up before he settles in. Really an odd look. Just as he gets ready here. Right there.
Mm-hmm.
Look at that.
Yeah.
I don't know what he's looking at either.
That's
knees, helmet, wiggle the cleats. Right there.
Studying the barrel of the bat.
Yeah. He's got it down.
Yeah.
I mean, it's repeatable.
A lot of stuff.
Yeah, it takes a while in between pitches.
Now, what does he do? Are the speed up rules being enforced this year?
Oh,
here's ball three. All right, so you're not supposed to leave the box.
He won't.
On ball three.
Stay in there. Nope. I think done. And they blame the pitchers, right?
Leave the box.
Yeah, he will, I think. Let's see. No, he's going to stay in there. Yeah, he got out of there a little bit. Not much, though.
So drag the box, go to the helmet, go to the gloves, back down, little bend.
You know, we were talking earlier about Big Daddy.
Yeah.
I wish he was on the mound right now.
Oh, yeah. Well, base hit. RBI single for Parker. 11-1. Mira Pena the triple. Blanco's been on base three times. Boscan went three plus, gave up seven runs. Caminero, two innings, one run. And this is into left field and a base hit. And left fielder Joyce. Shugo gave up a run in an inning, and now Rondon has given up a couple. It's been a long night for Clint Hurdle. Watched his starter go just three plus, and now like musical chairs, not only in the bullpen but on the diamond. The recent injury now to Marte, he's had to have John Jaso play some right field for just the second time in his career. Eric Kratz over at first. Jaso played a couple innings in August against the Astros right field for the first time in his career. Eric Kratz, first base. Joyce came into the ballgame initially with McCutchen leaving in a double switch. Joyce was in right now and left. Polanco in center. And 17 hits for the Giants. Kratz has played a couple of ball games at first base, so that's not totally foreign to him. Ball one on Connor Gillespie. Productive night for him. Flied out his first time up, but three straight hits, including a two-run homer. And this from a guy who was three for his previous 34 at-bats before that home run in the fourth. They're not calling off the dogs, are they, these Giants?
No.
And they're hanging in there.
Stealing bases or anything like that, but they're still trying to get their hits, and you can't blame the hitters for that.
I don't know if Steve Meckling is still here, but he had his retirement party.
earlier. We had a chance to see Steve and a group of folks on hand.
Only a half moon tonight, huh?
Yeah. Two and two. Connor Gillespie. Seen Steve for a long time, former sports director at WFMJ TV in Youngstown, Ohio. Great to see him again, and congratulations on his retirement. And that's a fair ball. Pass Kratz. Jaso up with it. Another run in. Gillespie, a four-hit night. 12 runs for the Giants.
Yeah. Real strong night for Gillespie.
Right.
Oh, is it? Man, that could have been foul. Yeah.
Take another look at that, maybe.
Yeah.
See if. Can't challenge that ball in front of the umpire. Yeah,
but still looked like it might have been.
Yeah, worth a look, right? Jim Reynolds.
It's hard to see here. But does that ball look like it goes?
It is so hard to see where it turns, where the bag was. The bag is. Ball.
I mean, it was
that angle.
You can't really argue that too much, but that could have been a foul ball. It's where that ball is when it's passing over the top of the bag. And I guess the only way you'd ever be absolutely sure is if you're hovering over the top of the bag looking straight down.
Another look from the splash cam. Good call, Jim Reynolds.
Well, 12-1, I guess it doesn't really matter. Whether it was fair or foul or not.
Trevor Brown pinch hitting.
How old is Tyler Glass now? Is he 24?
I looked that up for you, Bob.
Yeah, do you, fun, right?
I'm not on your crew, you know, just so you know that.
Well, I said it to you thinking that my research staff would look it up.
He is 22. What makes you ask that question?
Well, I believe that Brown. Oh, here's that play again. Now, remember, it's where it goes over the bag. Yeah. Hard tell. Like I said, you got to be looking straight down, but that's a nice shot right there.
Excellent shot.
Well, Brown, I believe, is 24. The hitter right now. He was a catcher at Hart High. Yeah. Perhaps he may have.
I'm sure they were teammates, probably, right?
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
Yeah.
You know, maybe senior sophomore.
Yeah. Control been a little bit of an issue for Glass now in his last couple of outings.
Still striking out at times.
Yeah, he is.
Not giving up many hits, but. Has been walking some folks.
Assumed that Chad Kuhl, who pitched last night, was a little bit more advanced in terms of his progress in the minor leagues. He pitched last night. Kuhl did anyway, and he struggled. 10 hits, even though he gave up 2 runs in 5 2/3, no walks, 3 strikeouts. Chad Kuhl is 6-2 at AAA. Glass now will make his next start tomorrow against the AAA affiliate of the Atlanta Braves. Glass now 6-2 and a 1.75 ERA, and there is another hit. Giants putting on one heck of a thumping on the Pirates.
19 base hits.
My word.
Go with those.
13 runs. I mean, Clint Hurdle doesn't want to use another reliever in this, but he's going to have to, as Rondon can't get the last out. So in a game that has been well out of hand for a while, unfortunately, he's going to have to go to another reliever. And it's Jared Hughes, a bullpen coach, coming into pitch.
By the authority of the Pittsburgh Pirates and may not be reproduced or retransmitted in any form, and the accounts and descriptions of this game may not be disseminated without the express written consent of the Pittsburgh Pirates.
Well, it has been a rough night for just about everyone, including Jorge Rondon, who goes 1 2/3, gives up to this point 4 runs, responsible for 2 on, give up 7 hits, and now Pirates forced to bring in Jared Hughes. Did not want to do that.
Man, this is just the eighth. You got another. You got the top of the ninth. You're gonna have, we're gonna have to cover also.
Yeah.
Somebody will have to pitch that.
This is one of the game. If you're on the road, you use a position player. Although there aren't many position players left for the Pirates. I don't know who you would, you know, have they used everyone? Stewart's not available, apparently. So, yeah, Gong, Kratz, Rodriguez, Joyce. Oh, Stewart's got a bat in hand anyway.
I was going to say, if you use a position player to pitch, you're going to have to use a pitcher to play in the field. Has that ever been done?
That's a good question. Now, that's just a... An unwritten rule in baseball. Game's out of hand, you try not to do it. I know years ago,
well,
it happened. The Pirates did use a position player at home.
You would just as soon not do that at home, but there are times where I guess your hand is forced. It depends on the manager. Some managers, I think, would probably do look at that as kind of a rule. But if they're going to do it on the road.
Runs, 19 hits for the Giants. And that's a base hit. Oh my goodness. Two more runs in. 15-1. Denard Span. And that unfortunately closes the book on a really rough night for Jorge Rondon.
Ball outside. He just kind of reached out and poked it. Got it inside the back.
Two run double for Denard Span. It's his third hit. He's driven in three. What's that? Eight doubles. 11 extra base hits. 20 total. And Rodriguez. Finally, the final out. And this is, well, a forgettable evening.
Hits the Pirates have allowed this season. They have a new career high, a new season high for them in hits for the Giants, 20 hits. National League West Volkswagen standings, the Dodgers trailing by 5.5 games in the National League West at the start of the day, and they are just underway in Los Angeles. The Dodgers hosting the Washington Nationals. The Nats get a home run from Bryce Harper, his 15th, early 1-0 lead. So a chance for the Giants to go 6.5 up. Gregor Blanco moves from right field to center field. George Contos now pitching, and it is Chris Stewart pinch hitting. Mack Williamson is in right. Trevor Brown catching.
Numbers for Contos this season, game number 24. In pretty good shape right there. ERA, opponent batting average.
Stewart will be. Whoa! What was that?
It was a horrible looking play.
My goodness. What was Cole Gillespie doing there?
I don't know. Okay, explanation.
He must have not. I guess he didn't have a grip initially when he got up. That's why he double clutched. And then almost fired the ball into Stewart's noggin.
And this is not a long throw. He's double clutched and he's way in on the grass and still made a horrible throw.
Wow.
And Stewart gets hit again.
Jeez, Stewart can't.
Got another bruise.
Now the big question, Bob, is who's going to pitch for the Pirates in the ninth?
I will say it's going to be.
It's going to be Sean Rodriguez.
Yeah.
He's been lobbying for it. And it's one of those situations, a true emergency.
Yeah, 15-1, even though you're at home. I got to do it.
David Freese launches one deep to right field off Contos, and something to cheer about. A two-run homer for David Freese, his sixth. Yeah, how about that? Don't tell him to score. That just made his night.
Every game, there's something to smile about. There it is. That's what I was waiting for. I don't want to see that smile. When the ball actually gets in the hand, that got to be just a classic moment for a young kid.
Eric Kratz sends one deep to left field. But not to be for Kratz tonight. The home run that won it last night. And Jarrett Parker toward the wall puts it away. Does that look again? Look at that reaction.
So the eyes look at it.
Pure joy.
He will remember this for a long, long time.
Talk about no quit, huh? Sticking around. Fired up.
Somebody got hit in the leg, it looks like.
Sean Rodriguez, who we think is going to be the pitcher.
He's probably the best hitting pitcher on the team.
Hit by a pitch in the seventh against Johnny Cueto. Don't know if there's any kind of history between those two, but
yeah, that kind of looked
like a purpose pitch, didn't it?
Suspicious, didn't it?
Right in the ribs. So he doubles here off Contos.
No, don't hit it again. Don't hit it again.
Let's go, Bucks champ. Good sign.
Don't ever give up. You see that picture of the frog and the stork? The frog is holding the stork's neck.
I don't think I have.
As the stork's trying to swallow him.
I don't think I have.
And at the bottom it says, never give up.
That's great.
We're the frog right now. But we're fighting. Yeah. We're fighting.
He'd like a baseball, right?
Where's he at? Is he over the home run fence? Let's hit him one. Yep. Right there on top of the committee wall. Just keep peppering that bleachers out there. Oh, I hear a Cueto chant. Did you hear that, Greg?
Yeah. Oh, a diving stop. At second base. So panic robs Mercer.
Put on the brakes. Also back. We've got a foot race with the shortstop now. Is that double seventh? Base hit, not Cueto out of this game. As fans shout Cueto, chant Cueto. There's Dad. He's looking for the second hit of the night.
Stallings the RBI double in the seventh. One on Stallings. Two and two on Stallings. The last Pirate position player to pitch was Jeff Decker in Cincinnati, July 30th last year. Looking as though we're going to see Sean Rodriguez take the mound in the ninth, and this will be something he can scratch off. Check off his bucket list. He will have played all nine positions at one point in his major league career.
Kind of cool to be able to say that.
Can't imagine there are a ton of players
that have done that,
even in the history of Major League Baseball. It might take some time to look that up, but it'd be interesting, wouldn't it? Even in the last 50 years or so.
There's been, I think, maybe two that have done it in one game.
Did Jose Oquendo do it?
I don't know, maybe. Bert Campaneris, I believe.
Oh, I think you're right.
He was the first one to do it.
That's right.
The Oakland A's.
Yep.
I think that was against the Angels.
Mm-hmm. You remember that, huh?
In Oakland. Oh, yeah.
You were watching?
Yeah. The announcers were confused early on in that game because no one told them what was going on.
Oh.
And so the first couple of innings, he kept moving around. Why is the starting shortstop not playing third? Why is he over? And then it. kind of dawned everybody. I'm guessing that was probably like a September game or something like that.
Strike three. Sean Rodriguez coming on to pitch. It's a full moon, and there is a young fan.
Well, looked like Sean Rodriguez was getting certainly lobbying to pitch, and it appeared as though Clint Hurdle had patted on the back and said, yeah, "Go ahead."
He wants to badly.
Yeah, so badly. It's the one position he's not played in the major leagues. Instead, Eric Kratz, for the second time this season, will take them out. Tomorrow, our coverage begins at 6:30. At PNC Park, the Pirates pregame presented by W.B. Mason on Root Sports. Break this one down.
Hasn't been a zero on the scoreboard since the third inning for the Giants. Can Kratz put one up?
Well, he throws a strike at 79 miles an hour.
They scored in the fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth.
Whoa, 52 miles an hour. Chris Stewart, by the way, is now at first.
Well, one thing, Greg, that might have tipped the decision in favor of Kratz is either Stewart or Kratz would have probably had to go over and play third. Right? If you brought Sean in from second base.
Yeah, I hear what you're saying, but at this point, you wonder, does it matter?
Well, I guess, yeah.
If Sean Rodriguez was going to be pitching for the first time in his career, would it have mattered if somebody played third for the first time in his career? In a 15-3 game.
Good point.
Now the fact that Kratz has pitched this season already, and whether that enters into it. It's a knuckleball he might be throwing at the speed of 50 miles an hour, 52. Hey! Strikes out Brandon Belt. How does a position player feel in a situation like that? You wonder.
They don't want to go to the plate right now.
Yeah. It's a no-win situation.
Yeah, if they get a base hit, nobody's going to notice. If they do that,
everybody notices.
Everybody notices. They'll be, you know, showing it on highlight shows, and it won't be fun for them.
Is he ever pitch?
Definitely going to go on Kratz's highlight reel.
And of course, they've got to authenticate it.
Did he get any strikeouts when he pitched earlier? Oh, why don't you look that up, Greg? Sorry. Don't look at me like that.
Two and one on Mac Williamson. Kratz again pitched against the Astros April 26th this year when he was with the Astros, rather.
Got that one up there at 80. Hopped up on it a little bit. One thing you certainly don't want to do when you're in the position of Kratz is don't do anything that put your arm in jeopardy. You don't want to get hurt.
He's going to get over to first base. A catcher.
Catcher to
Stewart,
catcher.
Onto the catcher at first.
They both caught it.
Not sure about the form covering.
Got it done, though.
A base hit for Ramiro Pena. In that game, Kratz pitching one inning earlier this year against Seattle. It was at Seattle. One inning, three hits, two runs, one earned.
No strikeouts?
No strikeouts.
No. Got that K. Got it. Check that bucket. Big league strikeout.
Out Brandon Belt. Oh, that's hit real hard at the bat of Jarrett Parker. Kratz faced Chris Iannetta of the Mariners, who singled off of him. Deho Lee grounded out. Seth Smith singled off of him. Nori Aoki singled off of him.
Center fielder Gregor Wanka.
And Ketel Marte and Luis Sardinas. Now Gregor Blanco. Fans yelling, "That a boy, Eric."
You know, it's kind of uncommon to have three catchers on a team, but to have them all three in a game at the same time.
Deep to center. Polanco, a nice catch. And a scoreless inning for Eric.
First clean inning any of the pitchers have had since the third.
bats. Catcher, first baseman, pitcher. Brandon Belt, he struck him out. His first big league strikeout was against the Giants first baseman, and this is the last out. Gregor Blanco driving it to center.
Looked like Eric kind of dropped his head a little bit right after contact. He thought maybe he had given up a long one. Blanco back there, right up against the wall. Bring it back.
Chatting with the authenticator, make sure
everything's authenticated.
Yeah. There's Matt Joyce. Chris Stratton. To bring this one home for the Giants.
Just five innings, but as you can see, pretty good five innings.
Well, you know, we wondered moments ago about Sean Rodriguez and where that would put him in baseball history. It is hard to believe that there have been only 14 players in Major League history to play all nine positions.
We got to get Sean in a game.
How about that? You mentioned Bert Campanaris did it in one game. That was in 1965. Cesar Tovar appeared in all nine positions with the Twins in September of 1968. Scott Sheldon of the Texas Rangers, September 6, 2000. All nine positions in one game. That same year, Shane Halter of the Tigers, October 1st, 2000, played all nine positions. No Pirate has ever done it in his career. The authenticator. There it is.
The little dot. What do you call the little the computer mark there?
Out. I'm not sure what you call that.
I think it's a QR code.
Oh, really?
What they call
you think
those.
So? What does the truck? What does the truck say?
I didn't ask.
Oh.
Yeah, yeah. There it is. See the JB above that, right? That's QR code.
Uh-huh. By the way, I reminded because the truck does give us a lot of information, or at least me. I don't know if they give you any, but Will Ferrell played all nine positions in spring training.
That's right. For like
nine different teams.
Nine different cities.
Yeah. If I'm not mistaken, I think Bugs Bunny did that also.
Yeah, he was the only guy on the field. He played all nine at the same time.
I think he beat them.
Yep.
Gas House Gorillas was the opponent.
They were really having their way with the. But Bugs came in and started pitching, and then that was the end. He shut him down.
That was the Bugs Bunny changeup.
Bugs, that's where the
that term came.
Where that saying comes
actually,
from.
Actually, that term is used.
Yep. When a guy has a great changeup, it's called a Bugs Bunny change. It's because of the that cartoon. Bugs had a tremendous changeup. Do you remember he struck out three guys on one changeup?
Oh, yeah, one pitch.
That's a good changeup.
Yeah. Gregory Polanco at the plate. By the way, one other note on position players playing nine positions in one game. Buster Posey did it as a junior at Florida State in 2008. How about that? And what would David Fries be talking to Kratz about? His pitching or
probably Fries probably got out there at some point maybe. A lot of these guys did some pitching in college. He'll do some pitching tomorrow.
We just got word that Starling Marte was taken out of the game with left foot discomfort.
Bochy move tonight?
I don't think.
Not in the times we've looked in the dugout. He's been locked in the seat. He hadn't really had to do much moving around tonight. No. 15 runs. At the early 7-0 lead.
Chance to talk with Bruce Bochy before the game on the radio pregame. And he talked about the fact that he really tried to emulate his first big league manager, Bill Verdon. Verdon would never embarrass you as a player. He expected you to hustle, be on time. And if he had an issue with you, never in public.
Obviously, a great man to learn from.
Yeah,
Bill Verdon.
Glad to hear that Bill Verdon is feeling better these days. Hope to see him maybe when the Bucks back to St. Louis. Three and two in Polanco, and you can hear his bench is hitting coach Jeff Branson still shouting words of encouragement.
Don't give away an at bat.
Shortstop there. Pena. Oh, close play. This is interesting. And there's a base hit for Gregory Polanco. This game is, you know, out of hand. It's over. But for Polanco, you know, you can understand if Clint Hurdle decides to challenge it.
Well, this will be a little payback if they challenge it and win for that. The ball strike when he was up there with the bases loaded last time. Yeah. And an opportunity to really do some damage, and basically the bat was taken out of his hands with the strike zone. So this would be a little payback for that, maybe. We showed those calls.
They are challenging it, and that doesn't even look close. I mean, it looks safe.
And this is you have to really reward effort like that too. I mean, we know what the score is.
Yeah.
And he hits a ground ball, goes down the line like that to try and get the infield hit. You have to challenge it.
Serve me something. El Cafe. Polanco looking for his second hit of the night. Safe. Overturned. And was credited with, initially I thought they called that an infield single, but an error was charged to Gillespie. The right call. Polanco, two of the Pirates' seven hits. A 22 hit attack for San Francisco Giants. Eric Kratz, the pitcher. Hit for Stewart.
Mm-hmm. balloons trying to get up above the buildings. Now the pitcher spot's on deck now.
Nobody warming in the Pirates bullpen. Freeze lines one deep to right center field. Freeze close to his second homer in as many at bats will get an RBI double.
Might have hit the yellow line. That was a line drive too. That wasn't one of those high ones. It just needed a little more height.
Pitcher Eric Kratz to the backup announces. Pitcher Eric Kratz. Yeah, that's close.
You know, if it wasn't right there by the stairs, where it takes a little jog up, if that was left or right, might have been a home run.
Last time a Pirate pitcher homered this season was Francisco Liriano, right? Pitcher.
Pitcher. Still fighting.
Yeah. This was last night. Eric Kratz. It's his first Pirate home run. Joe Pagan had it for a moment. The only run in the game last night. What a difference day makes.
That ball bounced.
Well, Kratz.
The ball bounced.
That wasn't even close. You could see it and hear it.
The ball bounced.
This could be challenged.
The ball bounced.
Clint Hurdle saying it's terrible. You guys want to get out of here. You could challenge that, can't you? Maybe not. You can't challenge that. He would certainly if you could. Clint Hurdle saying just leave. Everybody gone. You want to get out of this? Would it quit? That was terrible. That was obvious. So.
I understand exactly why Clint Hurdle is upset right here. It's been a tough night, sure, but, you know, his guys are still fighting, doing everything they can. And
look at that.
That's a foul ball.
Unbelievable.
That is a foul ball.
Foul ball that hit the ground.
Yeah, the reason I say it's a foul ball is because when the ball hits the bat and goes in the glove, it's a foul tip.
Yeah.
When it hits the ground, it's a foul ball.
Right. Yeah.
That's what it's a big difference between a tip and a foul ball.
That's right, yeah. I thought replay was supposed to get all the calls right. Let's go out to Robin Teague.
Greg and Bob, thanks very much. This game comes to a bit of a disquieting end. The Pirates losing by the final score of 15.